Gluten-free has become a multi-billion dollar industry. But is gluten really that bad for us, or is it all a fad? First things first, what is gluten? Unlike what some people may think, gluten is not a carbohydrate. It's actually a group of proteins found in some cereals. Now, it's completely clear that some of us are legitimately gluten intolerant, the most obvious case being celiac disease. People with celiac report not being taken seriously in restaurants and even facing dismissive attitude from some clinicians. So it's important to clarify that it is legitimate and serious, and they need to avoid gluten. It's not them being picky or something. Celiac disease affects approximately 1% of us. There are some typical gastrointestinal symptoms like abdominal pain, diarrhea, bloating, gas, or nausea. But interestingly, more than half of celiacs have symptoms that are not gastrointestinal, like anemia, headaches, numbness, or a skin rash. If you suspect you may have celiac disease, definitely get tested. It's a quick blood test. There are more elaborate tests, but that's the first step. Once diagnosed, the treatment for celiac disease is to eliminate all gluten. Now, one common misunderstanding is that gluten-free means no grains. In reality, only 3 grains have gluten: wheat, barley, and rye. That's it. But a lot of the foods we're familiar with are made with those 3 grains. Breads, pasta, baked goods, and all kinds of packaged processed foods. Even ketchup. Oh, and beer. Most beers are made from barley. Fortunately for those with celiac disease, there are gluten-free beers on the market. The rest of the grains outside of those 3 are gluten-free. There's actually 9 gluten-free grains. Let's see if I can rattle them off alphabetically. Amaranth, buckwheat, corn, millet, oats, quinoa, rice, sorghum, and teff. Boom! Nailed it! And I got them on the first take.
List of grains, take 37.
Okay, there is one caveat with oats though. They can get contaminated by being processed in the same facility as wheat. There are some gluten-free varieties of oats in the market, and they're processed separately to avoid contamination. Also, oats contain a protein called avenin, which is somewhat similar to gluten, but it's tolerated by the vast majority of people with celiac disease. So even if you have celiac disease, oats are probably okay as long as they're gluten-free, processed apart from wheat. If you have a reaction even to gluten-free oats, then you could be in that tiny minority that can't handle even avenin. Another thing to watch out for, only those 3 cereals have gluten, but wheat answers to many different names. Some common ones are bulgur, couscous, durum, farro, kamut, seitan, semolina, spelt, triticale, and triticum. Boom! Nailed it again, first take. So those are all types of wheat or made from wheat, so beware. Okay, so that's celiacs. What about the 99% of us who don't have celiac disease? There's a notion in some circles that gluten is just bad for humans, period. Some people go even further and say, cut all grains from your diet. So let's take a look at the evidence on the health effects of gluten. But we have to be very careful when we draw conclusions. Otherwise, it's very easy to get confused. Here's what I mean. Take this study, for example. They gave people gluten, and their gastrointestinal symptoms went up. They actually got worse. So maybe it is true. Maybe gluten is poison, and we should all go against the grain. Maybe all grains are poison. Hold on, aren't we missing something? How do we know the problem was the gluten? Maybe something else happened during the experiment. Maybe they ate something else that caused the symptoms. What we need is a control group. Same conditions, everything the same, and we give them the same food, just no gluten. What's called a placebo. Lucky for us, that study did just that. And the volunteers were blinded, meaning they didn't know if they were getting the bread with or without gluten. And the placebo without gluten caused symptoms to also go up. So this is what we call a nocebo effect. Placebo effect is when even an inert treatment like a sugar pill shows benefit. Nocebo is the opposite. Even the control without gluten showed symptoms. It doesn't necessarily mean it's psychological. It could be. But it could also be something about the dietary change, the fact that a new food is being introduced. Or it could be a different component of the food. Point is, in this case, we can't blame the gluten. And if we didn't have that control group, we would be completely misled. This is why anecdotes can be really confusing, because it's hard to know what else changed. Now, the problem is, a lot of these trials use volunteers who already have some kind of gastrointestinal issue at baseline before the study starts, like irritable bowel or some food intolerance. So maybe gluten is bad. It's just being masked by their other symptoms. What we need to do is test completely healthy people, no gastrointestinal issues whatsoever to begin with. Give them placebo or gluten and see what happens. This recent trial did exactly that. And gluten did not induce any gastrointestinal symptoms. So the evidence to date has led to the scientific opinion that gluten is safe for the general population. So it's okay to be a glutton for gluten. We can think of gluten kind of like strawberries. Some people are allergic, but that doesn't make the food toxic for all humans. Okay, so gluten is okay for healthy people and definitely not okay for those with celiac disease. That's pretty clear. What about the gray area? There's always a gray area. Some people test negative for celiac disease but are still gluten intolerant. It's called non-celiac gluten sensitivity, or great acronym, scientists. Non-celiac gluten sensitivity is not well understood yet. It's what's called a diagnostic of exclusion. If you have symptoms after eating a gluten-containing food, and if celiac disease and wheat allergy have been ruled out, then you're diagnosed with non-celiac gluten sensitivity. Okay, what's the deal with this non-celiac gluten sensitivity, NCGS? Is this even real? Several studies have tested people identifying as gluten intolerant through a blind challenge. Give them gluten or a placebo without them knowing which is which, and see if they can guess. Scientists are a really mistrusting bunch. These tests show that people identifying as gluten intolerant are a heterogeneous population. Some have symptoms after eating gluten, but not placebo. But others can't tell which is which. For example, this trial found that symptoms increased while eating gluten compared to placebo, but only in a minority of participants. This thorough analysis looked at 10 of these studies and concluded non-celiac gluten sensitivity is confirmed in a few patients. 16% of people identifying as gluten intolerant were confirmed. This tells us two things. Number one, some people who test negative for celiac disease still show legitimate sensitivity to gluten. And number two, many people who are lumped as gluten intolerant may in fact be intolerant to other components of food. This should not be mistaken with people making it up. As these scientists say, it is counterproductive to debate whether non-celiac gluten sensitivity is real. The patients are real. This is a great mindset. The patients are real. The complaints are real. We may not know exactly what the cause is in every single case, but that's on us to figure out. And there are several good candidates. One is irritable bowel. IBS is often managed with an elimination diet called a low FODMAP diet. One study found that people who identified as gluten intolerant responded well to a low FODMAP diet. Their symptoms improved. And once they were on that diet, giving them gluten had no effect. So some people who appear to be gluten intolerant may in fact have IBS. Another possibility is wheat allergy, as we mentioned earlier. It's specific to wheat and it's more common in children. Alternatively, it could also be an intolerance to another component of wheat, other than gluten. These scientists explain, the condition, referring to non-celiac gluten sensitivity, remains ill-defined. It's still a matter of debate whether NCGS is caused by gluten or other components of wheat. In fact, some experts suggest it may be more accurate to call it non-celiac wheat sensitivity, or another great one, guys. Just rolls right off the tongue. It's also possible that in some cases it is celiac disease, but it was misdiagnosed. Or it could be a milder form that evades the tests. Certainly the amount of gluten is a critical consideration. People who don't have full-blown celiac disease may be able to handle a small amount of gluten, but not a larger one, which of course makes diagnosis harder. And finally, because gluten comes in many junky foods, like snacks, candies, baked goods, etc., if you feel better after eliminating those, it could be the overall quality of the food, or any of the artificial components, rather than gluten itself. Here's an easy test. Try eating some barley. Don't complicate it, just a barley soup or boiled barley. If you feel a reaction, it may indeed be the gluten. But if you're fine, you're probably not gluten intolerant per se. Now, if you're thinking, this is a little confusing, you're not alone. The only thing experts seem to agree on is that non-celiac gluten sensitivity is not simple. Scientists complain about the confusing uncertainty on the true culprit for non-celiac gluten sensitivity. And check out this line. The strange world of non-celiac gluten sensitivity is complex and will not give up its secrets easily. Okay, settle down, J.K. Rowling. You know it's a puzzle when even Harvard admits gluten sensitivity is a baffling condition. So we should resist the temptation to oversimplify and paint everything with a broad stroke. Sometimes biology has a lot of moving pieces. Hey, keeps things interesting, right? Bottom line, if you're negative for celiac disease, but you notice a reaction to gluten, don't dismiss it. You could be in that subset that is gluten sensitive, or it could be an intolerance to something else in wheat, or it could be a related condition like IBS, So definitely see a specialist for some proper differential diagnosis. By the way, we're working on a series of videos with a board-certified gastroenterologist. We'll touch on all of these topics and much more, so stay tuned. So, to summarize, most people can eat all grains. People with gluten intolerance should avoid the 3 gluten grains, but can eat the other 9 gluten-free grains. And people with wheat allergy should avoid wheat, but can usually handle all the other grains. Okay, so why not play safe and just eliminate gluten for everybody? Gluten is not essential. It just seems simpler. Well, there are some concerns that cutting gluten may worsen dietary quality. Some studies report that people on gluten-free diets consume low levels of several key nutrients and more saturated and hydrogenated fats. Also, a 2017 study found lower risk of coronary heart disease associated with eating whole grains, and concluded that the avoidance of gluten may result in reduced consumption of beneficial whole grains, which may affect cardiovascular risk. The promotion of gluten-free diets among people without celiac disease should not be encouraged. I suspect those concerns are not inherent to gluten-free diets. What's happening is, because a lot of Westerners get most of their fiber from breads and pasta, when those foods are off the table, overall fiber intake goes down, especially if they're replaced with junkier gluten-free foods. Maybe that's why disease risk goes up. But of course, it doesn't have to be that way. Diets low in gluten don't have to be low in fiber. So, if you have to avoid gluten, number one, avoid replacing it with ultra-processed gluten-free foods, which the market is full of. And number two, avoid removing whole grains entirely or substantially reducing overall dietary fiber. One obvious move is to replace the 3 gluten grains with the other 9 gluten-free ones. And you should be good to go. Here's more on fiber and grains and their effect on gut health. And here's some ways to include some delicious whole grains into your diet. Check them out. See you next time. Stay well.